live from a bunker in Taylor, Michigan, here's Banger.
Well, the host is getting noticed. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to another rendition of the John Lebang Show on this Our Lord and Savior's second inauguration day. I'm sure the next 4 years of the Imperium will prove interesting. So as I spoke in the opening, my show and website got some attention in a local magazine just released for the February edition of the Detroit Live magazine. They do a nice little write-up on me. So if you're obliged to go and read it yourself, I'll provide the link in the description box of the YouTube video. Or if you just can't wait to read it, you can go to DetroitLive.com. That's www.DetroitLive.com. And so Obama was sworn in today, and we'll have to deal with him for the next 4 years. President Obama launched his second term Monday with a call for the United States to continue its never-ending journey to live up to the ideals of its founders. On his way out, with the oath taken again and the speech delivered, he stopped and for about 24 seconds.
Everybody in Cleveland, low minority, got Obama phone. Keep Obama in president, you know? He what? Gave us a phone.
Give you a phone.
Do more.
How do you give you a phone?
You sign up. If you're on food stamps, you on Social Security, you got low income, you disability.
Hey, I have a question. Okay, what's wrong with Romney again?
Romney, he sucks. Hey.
We have exactly 1,461 more days of Obama. That is, if he doesn't decide to try for it.
The president alluded to a second-term agenda that includes immigration reform. Ladies and gentlemen, before I go on,
why is it that every president has immigration reform on the docket, on the agenda, and it never, ever, ever gets fixed?
Protecting entitlements from budget cuts and defending the vulnerable from a warming climate and gun violence. It was a thematic preview of the next month's State of the Union address, which he will use to more fully detail his plans and approach. Is Obama the second coming? Has anybody seen the Newsweek article or the Person of the Year from Time? Or even the New Yorker, where Obama is herding a bunch of cats? Is Obama the second coming? How did the rest of the media miss this? According to the new issue of Newsweek online, President Obama, who this week begins his second term, the third president in a row to do so, is
the second coming.
With flattering photographs, the magazine edited by Obama fan Tina Brown holds out hope that, in his second inaugural address, Obama can inspire and show that he can also lead. Conservatives have long joked that the National Press Corps sees Obama as the second coming of Christ. Today's Newsweek made it official, said Center Vice President Brent Baker. Next to the side shot of Obama's head, the inauguration 2013 cover story pronounces
the second coming.
Baker notes that the author, longtime Newsweek veteran Evan Thomas, gave Obama godlike qualities during his first year in office, saying on MSNBC,
"In a way, Obama is standing above the country, above the world. He's sort of a god. He's going to bring all different sides together."
Oh, he did such a wonderful job on that, didn't he, Mr. Thomas? Oh, yes.
Obama brought the whole country together. Yeah.
I still don't understand how this guy got back in office, to be honest with you, ladies and gentlemen. It's got to be this godlike thing going on. That can be the only explanation outside of the whole thing's rigged and they wanted Obama there in the first place, which is very possible. Because if you look at what has gone on, have looked at all the numbers, compared them to prior presidents, this man does not even stack up to Bush. Oh, I'm sorry, Left, did that hurt? Let me go through a few things for you. Americans not in the labor force increased by 8,332,000 people last year. Americans age 16 and older who decided not to work or even to seek jobs increased by 8,332,000 people to a record 88,839,000 in President Obama's first term, according to the Bureau of Labor and Statistics. The increases in Americans opting out of the labor force during Obama's first term resulted in a decrease in the labor force participation rate from 65.7% in January 2009, the month Obama was first inaugurated, to 63.6% in December 2012, the last month reported. Before Obama took office, the labor force participation rate had not been as low as 63.6% since 1981, the year President Ronald Reagan took over for President and loser Jimmy Carter. In a comparable period of George Bush's second term, the number of Americans choosing not to participate in the labor force went from 76,800 in January 2005 to 80,380,000 in December 2008, an increase of 3,500,000 plus. In Bush's first term, the number of Americans choosing not to participate in the workforce went from 70 million in January 2001 to 76,500,000 in December 2004, an increase of 6.5 million people. And then the unemployment rate seems to be the same when Obama took office. It's 7.8% right now. Except I just read you a story where 8 million people were not counted anymore in the workforce. I wonder what, if you add those 8 million people to the workforce,
how high would the unemployment rate really be?
It's funny because Obama's first term approval rating was among the lowest to post since World War II for any president. President Barack Obama averaged a 49.1% job approval rating during his first term in office, among the lowest of post-World War II presidents, according to Gallup poll. Only Jimmy Carter and Gerald Ford had a lower approval averages in their first term. Here's how the presidents stacked up after their first term. Lyndon B. Johnson, 74.2%. Kennedy, 70.1%. Eisenhower, 69.6%. George W. Bush, 62.2%. George H.W. Bush, 60.9%. Nixon, 55.8%. Truman, 55.6%. Reagan, 50.3%. Clinton, 49.6, Obama 49.1, Ford 47.2, and Jimmy Carter rounds it off at a grand 45.5%.
Now, George W. Bush's numbers might be elevated slightly because of that event called 9/11, and that probably boosted his early ratings pretty high, but still, George W. Bush has 62.2% approval rating as a president after his first term.
Obama, 49.1. How do you like that? How do you on the left enjoy hearing that George W. Bush, the most hated man according to the left? How do you like it that George Bush, after his first term, averaged 62.2% and Obama's only at 49.1%? And he's your god. Oh. And Obama's doing such a great job and he's worrying about jobs that his job council has hit 1 year without officially meeting. Yep. Also under Obama, Americans collecting disability increased 1.3 million people. One person for every 13 full-time workers. That's not counting what we're paying for Social Security and for food stamps and for... get it? Welfare. Which all have increased under Obama. More people are on Social Security now. More people are on welfare. More people are on food stamps. But America's doing just fine, isn't it, America? Yep. We're doing grand under Obama. It's awesome. How can we not be doing grand under Obama? House Republicans offer path to avert debt ceiling standoff for now.
Like sands through the hourglass, so are the days of our lives.
House Republicans said Friday they would allow a vote next week on a short-term increase in the debt ceiling. A move that could avert a risky standoff with President Barack Hussein Obama,
the Lord and Savior of the world,
at least for now. Meeting at a retreat in Virginia, House GOP leaders said they would move on a measure allowing the government to borrow for about 3 more months. Without the extension, the country is expected to exhaust the authority by mid-February, risking the possibility of a market-rattling default. While Obama has warned Republicans not to challenge him on the debt ceiling, Republicans still see the issue as a key leverage to extract spending cuts from Democrats at the time when the debt is well above $16 trillion. The bill is meant to buy time if Congress refuses to raise the debt ceiling by February 15th and the government ends up short of cash to pay its bills on time. The proposal would require that revenue flowed to the Treasury Department would first be allocated toward the U.S. debt, Social Security, and active duty military pay. So that means, ladies and gentlemen, all of you on welfare and food stamps, on unemployment, all that, are going to have to worry because...
That whole physical cliff thing that happened New Year's Eve to New Year's Day into the new year was a Band-Aid, and now they gotta make another Band-Aid, and they're gonna keep Band-Aiding all these crises just so Obama can keep everybody on a crisis footing. This man loves crisis.
He was saying, Republicans don't challenge me on the debt ceiling. In other words, guess what? I don't care about the debt ceiling. That's what Obama's saying. I don't care about the debt ceiling. I don't care about raising taxes, and I don't care about the debt ceiling. And we're not going to cut anything. Nothing. Republicans, you can shove it. That's exactly what Obama is saying to the Republicans. He's giving them the one-finger salute. Bada boom, bada beep. Yes, baby. Right up there. And of course, he's in this mode of
curbing gun violence
in the United States. Another sign that the country is not doing well. But obviously, the American public cannot see this. The people who voted for Obama must think the whole country is doing great. And here's Obama putting out these 23 executive orders, most of which were junk to pacify the left. But a lot of the stuff in there related to healthcare, Obamacare, the CDC, and health insurance. Doctors talking about people's mental health, mental illness. Here's a little story from U.S. News, NBC News. Anger, violent thoughts? Are you too sick to own a gun? If there's one thing Republicans and Democrats can agree on, it's that mentally ill people should not have access to firearms. Bingo, ladies and gentlemen, did you hear that? Bingo, this is how they're going to do it. They're just going to declare people mentally unfit, and they'll either make it hard as hell to get your guns, go purchase a new one, or take it away from you, saying you're mentally unfit. And who's going to argue with them when we have a place like Waco go on again here in the United States? Who's going to argue with the government?
Oh, they were so mentally unfit, and they stood up against the big government, big brother, Janet Napolitano. Yes, they stood up against them, and that's a bad thing. Oh, that's such a bad thing.
But as lawmakers rush to restrict the access in the wake of recent mass shootings, mental health experts warn of unintended consequences, from gun owners avoiding mental health treatment to therapists feeling compelled to report every patient who expresses
a violent thought.
Many patients express some idea of harm to other people. Everything from, I wish I could rip my boss's limb from limb, to, I have a gun and I want to blow that guy away, said Paul Applebaum, director of the Division of Law, Ethics, and Psychiatry at Columbia University. Therapists usually interpret this sort of talk as part of the treatment process, experts say. But under the new law in New York, one of the strongest to be passed to date, therapists may feel compelled to report every instance of violent talk, lest they face legal consequences if something happens. And some say ordinary patients may wind up suffering the most. Several polls conducted since this shooting in Newtown have found a widespread support for new legislation that would restrict the possession of firearms by the mentally ill, as well as for increased government spending on mental health. Are you getting it, ladies and gentlemen? This is what they're going to try to do. They are just going to put tons of restrictions on mentally ill people so they cannot purchase firearms and they cannot keep their firearms. All while that's happening, they're telling the doctors and the insurance companies and the states to rat out everybody who might have depression, You might have a kid with autism. Do you see how this affects a whole lot of people, ladies and gentlemen? Because you don't even have to have the mental illness. If your son or daughter has autism and they pass some kind of law restricting anyone with mental illness to be within a certain distance of a gun, guess what? You won't be able to have a gun because you'll be breaking the law because your son or daughter has a mental illness. This is where it's heading. They are going to disarm us by calling us all mentally ill. So, in my search for what they're trying to do, I go to the CDC website. That's the Center for Disease Control. And I go look up some statistics on mental illness. And according to the CDC, an estimated 1 in 10 U.S. adults report depression. And people say, well, okay, that's fine. But according to the CDC, that's the government, depression is a
mental illness
that can be costly and debilitating to sufferers. Depression can adversely affect the course and outcome of common chronic conditions such as arthritis, asthma, cardiovascular disease, cancer, diabetes, and obesity. Depression also can result in increased work absenteeism, short-term disability, and decreased productivity. The CDC's study lists the most likely to meet the criteria for major depression. Now get this, ladies and gentlemen. Persons 45 to 64 years of age are one of the criteria for major depression. Women, one of the criteria for major depression. Being black, Hispanic, non-Hispanic persons of other races or multiple races. Persons with less than a high school education. Those previously married. Individuals unable to work or unemployed. And persons without health insurance coverage. Now, ladies and gentlemen, that list covers about 85% of America. In the future, this is not just for people now. This is a long-term agenda. Let me run some of this by you. Autism spectrum disorders. Okay? Everybody familiar with that? If you're not, just look up autism, okay? About 1 in 88 children have been identified with an autism spectrum disorder, according to estimates from the CDC's Autism and Development Disabilities Monitoring Network. ASD is almost 5 times more common in boys, 1 in 54, than among girls, 1 in 252. 1 in 6 children in the United States has a developmental disability ranging from mild disabilities such as speech and language impairments to serious development disabilities such as intellectual disabilities, cerebral palsy, and autism. So now let's look at this as I've read those two things. I've read the depression and I've read about autism. 1 in 10 Americans by the CDC have a mental illness. Passing legislation that's going to restrict people with mental illnesses from obtaining a firearm? Well, ladies and gentlemen, if they make it up to depression, and we don't know how far they're willing to go, but remember, they're tying this into Obamacare, and doctors are going to be encouraged to rat you out. As well as your health care provider, your health insurance, and now your states, according to the 23 executive actions taken by President Barack Hussein Obama. Now, in the future, if 1 in 6 adults, because we're saying 1 in 6 children now have disabilities, mental disabilities, and it doesn't seem like anybody is opposed to blocking mentally unstable people from getting weapons. So it's not that they have to take away the guns. All they have to really do is declare you mentally unstable. Very much how they are declaring everybody a terrorist now. So you're either going to fall into two camps in the future. You're going to be mentally unstable, having a mental illness of some sort, or you're going to be a terrorist. That's it. That's going to cover a wide spectrum of people. That will make it a lot easier to get the guns out of people's hands if you're just not allowed to buy them in the first place. And there's been talk that they're going to try to block guns from being passed down through generation to generation. You see where that's going, ladies and gentlemen? They don't have to rush to through gun control. They don't have to come get our guns. What they can do is wait us out, declare everybody mentally unfit, or a good portion of us, and then over time, very few people have weapons, and then it's a lot easier to, let's say, become a tyranny. Chicago official wants GPS devices on all guns. Oh, that's nice. We already have them on our phones. Some people put them in their dogs. I mean, for some kids, they have to have them on their little wristbands for their school cafeteria. We already have them in our credit cards. I mean, how many GPS devices do we need, really? Actor Danny Glover tells students Second Amendment was created to protect slavery. You're such an idiot. You know, Danny, I liked all your Lethal Weapon movies, and I liked a couple of your other movies that you're in, but you're stupid. Do you even know the Second Amendment? Here, let me recite it, because people who study this actually know it off the top of their head. Okay, watch. A well-regulated militia, being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms, shall not be infringed, Mr. Danny Glover. Anti-drone hoodie can make its wearer invisible to spies in the sky. Those concerned about the conspiratorial machinations of the surveillance infrastructure can now swap their tinfoil hats for a more fashion-conscious accessory. A New York-based artist has designed an anti-drone hoodie stitched from material used to counter the infrared cameras that spy drones use to spot people on the ground. It is part of the line of high-tech stealthwear that can thwart cameras and block tracking signals, which has been unveiled in London this week. Also on offer is a pouch for carrying mobile phones made from a special fabric which blocks the signal so it can't be tracked or intercepted by authorities. And there is also a shirt designed with an X-ray shielding print in the shape of a heart, which is intended to protect the wearer's heart from damaging X-ray radiation. Strongest evidence yet to there being life on Mars. Martian rocks from a crater hit by a meteor may contain the strongest evidence yet that there is life on Mars. Professor John Parnell, 55, has co-written a theory with Dr. Joseph Bolesky a planetary geologist at the Natural History Museum. That suggests they have discovered the best signs of life in a huge crater on the surface of Mars. The document published today in Natural Geoscience Journal describes how they assessed the crater. Created by a meteor flinging up rocks from miles below, the rocks appear to be made up of clay and minerals which have been altered by water, the essential element to support life. Speaking from his laboratory in the University of Armandine, geochemist Professor Parnell said,
"We could be so close to discovering if there is or was life on Mars. We know from studies that a substantial portion of all life on Earth is also in the subsurface, and by studying the crater, we can see similar conditions behind the surface of Mars, thanks to observations on the rocks brought up by the meteor strike. There can be no life on the surface of Mars because it is bathed in radiation and it's completely frozen. However, life in the subsurface would be protected from that. And there is no reason why there isn't bacteria or other microbes that were or still are living in the small cracks well below the surface of Mars. One of the things we have discussed in our paper is that this bacteria could be living off hydrogen, which is exactly the same way as what microbes beneath the surface of the Earth are doing."
Professor Parnell reckons that although the next mission to Mars will have a drill to examine possibilities of life beneath the surface of Mars, his new study suggests looking around the edges of the crater would be easier and more beneficial.
"And then the aliens from below the surface might recognize that we've come to their planet and feel offended and come and fly their ships to our planet and blow us up."
Iran is set to unveil a new space observatory that will serve as the centerpiece of its space program and may launch live creatures into orbit in the coming days, according to the state-run media reports. That's funny they mention it like that, because I believe our media here is also state-run media. As we continue, the new space base will act as a headquarters from which the Iranian military can monitor Tehran's future space missions, according to Iran's defense minister, who was quoted on Monday in Iran's Far News agency. Tehran will also unveil sometime between the end of January and early February the latest homemade jet fighter planes. The Mir news agency quoted Iranian's brigadier general, who served as a regime minister of the defense and armed forces logistics, saying that the new space base will oversee Iranian space cargo missions. Asked if Iran will dispatch any living creatures into space, the brigadier general said,
"God willing, this will be done in the coming days."
Several reports indicate Iran's goal is to send monkeys into space. Harvard professor seeks mother for cloned cave baby. They're usually thought of a brutish, primitive species. So what woman would want to give birth to a Neanderthal baby? Yet, this incredible scenario is the plan of one of the world's leading geneticists, who is seeking a volunteer to bring man's long-extinct close relative back to life. Professor George Church of Harvard Medical School believes he can reconstruct Neanderthal DNA and resurrect the species which became extinct 33,000 years ago. His scheme is reminiscent of Jurassic Park, but while in the film dinosaurs were created in the laboratory, Professor Church's ambition plans requires
a human volunteer.
He said his analysis of Neanderthal genetic code using samples from bones is complete enough to reconstruct their DNA. He said,
"Now I need an adventurous female."
Oh, well, don't we all? Hey, Mr. Church, we all need those adventurous females to let us feel their surface and their subsurface.
Professor Church's plan would begin by artificially creating Neanderthal DNA based on a genetic code found in fossil remains. He would put this DNA into stem cells. These would be injected into cells from a human embryo in the early stages of life. Do we really have to go here? Do we really have to resurrect a Neanderthal? What is the purpose? And being that he's a Neanderthal, does he have human qualities? I mean, is he going to have freedoms? If he's not going to have freedoms, then he becomes a laboratory experiment. He becomes an animal in a cage. Where is that morally right, ladies and gentlemen? The things we do as a human race to push the limits is utterly amazing. Why do we have to go here? Why? Okay, ladies and gentlemen, that's it for this edition of the John LeBang Show. And until next time, this is John LeBang, and I am signing out.